Anybody know what this is? Who this is? Who wrote this? What the song is? You don't know who the band is. You old timers. Yeah, you've got to be about 100 years old to get this guy. All right. In 1921, Irving Berlin, the most important popular American composer in the 20th century, wrote Say It With Music, which would become his theme song. Berlin's lyrics, typically simple and straight to the heart, include the following. Music is a language lovers understand. Melody and romance wander hand in hand. Cupid never fails, assisted by a band. So if you have something sweet to tell her, say it with music, beautiful music. And that's what we're going to be doing for the next couple of hours. I'll be giving two lectures today. One on the importance of 20th century popular music to us evangelicals, and the other on why that important music was written largely by heirs of the Old Testament church. And along the way, I'll be sprinkling my lectures with some classic popular songs. Well, why should we, Bible-believing Christians, enjoy or even care about American popular music that was written 60, 80, 100 years ago, largely by non-Christians, when our society is in a moral freefall and hostility to Jesus and his followers is increasing? Why should we fiddle with Frank while our country burns with Baal? I think important theological and moral issues are at stake here, and we'll talk about those. And besides, didn't Paul tell the European Christians at Corinth that the spiritual man makes judgments about all things, including music? And if we really believe that there is nothing new under the sun, then the themes and the structures of the best American popular songs that are a part of our musical heritage will be found in God's revelation. So these lectures are an attempt to do that finding with the most enjoyable musical genre, the Great American Songbook. To set before us the importance of the Great American Songbook, I turn to Yale classical musicologist Alan Forte, no particular fan of the songbook, who argues that, as he calls it, the classic American popular music in the 20th century is unique on four counts. First, it is the largest notated body of solo song with English language text in existence. Second, it is the last large corpus of music based on traditional tonality. Third, it has been subjected to a greater range of performance variability than have those of any other repertoire. And fourth, its musical value has been certified by performing musicians of talent and taste for over a century. And we'll be listing some of those over the next couple of hours. Let me give a broad definition of the best of the American popular music, the evergreens, the standards, the perennial favorites of the American public. The collection of popular American songs, the American Songbook, is generally about love between a man and a woman, with a basic storyline of boy meets girl, boy loses girl, and sometimes boy finds girl, which is a popular versification, I will contend, of creation, fall, redemption, and consummation. The American Songbook is the closest thing Americans have that created the approach to a popular expression of the culture of transcendence. The golden age of the Golden Songbook was roughly between 1900 and the 1960s, when quality popular music was finally eviscerated by rock and roll. The gold miners were George M. Cohan, Jerome Kern, Irving Berlin, Cole Porter, Richard Rodgers, Larry Hart, and on and on and on, up to recently Stephen Sondheim and Burt Bacharach. The songbook is comprised of three basic categories of songs. The Tin Pan Alley song, or what some people call popular low culture, Hollywood film songs, popular mid-culture, and Broadway songs, popular high culture. The fact that the songbook canon is basically chaste and appropriate for Christian use is evidenced by its appropriation by churches, schools, and organizations in public performance. The songs are largely decent and modest because they were written in a more decent and modest time in our culture, the first 60 or so years of the 20th century. And as always, popular music have reflected the social norms of every country and in every age. No American reaches adulthood without at least one experience of watching a musical in New York or a touring professional company or performing in a high school, college, church, or amateur theater production, or humming or dancing to a Tin Pan Alley song. One cannot enter an office building, a medical lobby, a shopping mall, an elevator, or a Christmas shop without hearing the songs of the American Songbook. It is generally agreed that the popular song of the 20th century had the largest impact on the individual American of any art form. Furthermore, America exported this popular art form all over the world in a massive cultural hegemony. We Americans composed, they played, they sang, and they danced to what we created. This was not European music, but American music. So if one wants to be culturally literate about Americana, then it is important to be familiar with the American Songbook. Because of that, there are scores of books written about the source, the history, the development of the American popular love ballad. But I haven't found any book that analyzes this musical genre through the grid of Christian theology. We evangelicals believe that all of life is to be governed, informed, and enlightened by holy revelation. And thus we believe that God speaks to our romantic yearnings. Since parts of the biblical songbook, the Song of Songs, and all of the American songbook are songs of romance, sometimes fallen romance, but romance nonetheless, we should therefore look to see how these two song collections, the biblical songbook and the American songbook, are connected. This means that, at least in this first hour, we will look at the doctrine of common grace, and then we will look at biblical romance. I define common grace as all that God does to restrain the influence of sin in the world on one hand, and all that he does to maintain, enrich, and develop the life of mankind generally and individually on the other hand. Now, there's a negative and a positive aspect to common grace. Popular entertainment can be hostile to biblical convictions, and sometimes it's safer to separate. But the Bible is full of exhortations and examples of God's people being involved in the dominant but hostile culture in which they live. Whether it's the general culture or the political culture or the artistic culture, God's people are to be in that culture, creating it. There is a direct correlation between love for the Creator and love for godly cultivating. Even parts of our culture that have become morally repellent are to have our presence ministering in our own way, as Paul reminds the Corinthian believers in 1 Corinthians 5. The Corinthian response to Paul's a lost first letter not to associate with immoral people was, well, how can we live in Corinth and not rub shoulders with immoral people? And Paul replies in 1 Corinthians 5, well, you cannot not associate with immoral people, and you ought not to abstain from associating with immoral people in the world. Paul says, I am referring to associating with immoral people in the church, not the world. So be engaged, he says, in the world. In the scriptures, we are given wonderful examples of stalwarts of our faith who knew the poems, the songs, the literature, and the cultural mindset of those of the surrounding biblical surrounding unbelieving culture. Moses, Daniel, and Paul come to my mind quickly as those that knew the artistic expressions of their culture. Because of the cultural mandate in Genesis 1 and 2, everything follows human cultivation of the Garden of God. Politics, economics, sociology, art, etc. It is part of our identity as redeemed children, or as Meredith Klein would say, princely gardeners of God, to cultivate and preserve his garden, the earth, not only for his glory, but for our enjoyment and pleasure. Our mandate is first to understand, and then to make and to keep a lovely habitation for the human race. And music is part of that endeavor to beautify our environment. If we are to understand our post-Christian culture as Christian music lovers, we need to be informed and corrected by those outside the faith, like Moses was with the Midianite priest Jethro in Exodus 18. The world is our intellectual oyster, ready to be harvested for God's glory and our enjoyment, and the scriptures are full of examples of unbelieving Egyptians, Midians, Babylonians, and Greeks helping God's children and vice versa. God generates and sustains human culture by distributing creative gifts and talents among all individuals and communities for the benefit of all. Now, concerning popular music and the church, archaeology and scriptures have shown that musicians in the Old Testament church took much of their music from neighboring civilizations, particularly the Sumerians and Egyptians. After all, Abraham was a son of Samaria, and the church spent centuries in Egypt. But Old Testament scholarship has shown that the Babylonians, the Assyrians, the Chaldeans, the Phoenicians, the Phrygians, the Lydians all contributed to the popular musical heritage given to us through the Old Testament church. The popular songs of the Old Testament church had practically the same domestic importance as singing the Psalms did in sacred music. 15 different species of popular songs in the Old Testament have been identified, such as war songs, work songs, wedding songs, and love songs. In fact, there is an entire Old Testament book given over to the passionate and explicit love songs of the church, the Song of Songs. In Psalm 145, David says to the Old Testament believers, "Tell the story of God's mighty acts, of his awesome works, of his majestic splendor, of his great deeds." The great Jewish singer of tales is repeatedly reminding us that we are a storytelling tribe. And the story we believers love to tell is the greatest love story ever told, the love between God and man. The biblical narrative gives us the pattern for this love story, creation, fall, redemption, and consummation. And because of that primary love story, there is a secondary love story, and that is the love between humans. Richard Pratt tells us God gave us stories to tell others, and the biblical love between a man and a woman is one of those necessary stories we need to tell to our neighbors, particularly in our time. Concerning the love story between a man and a woman, the fourfold story pattern, creation, fall, redemption, consummation, is explicitly followed in the biblical songbook and in the best American songbook lyrics. It is really quite remarkable. Christian musicologist Jeremy Bigby, echoing Dutchman LaBrieite Hans Ruckmacher and Mars Hill Audio Ken Myers, argues that music can glorify God without necessarily having an evangelical message tagged to it, simply by having musical and lyrical excellence and by expressing God's heart, which in the case of the American songbook is romance. Which leads me naturally to the idea that we Christians are to be romantic lovers. In 1932, Rodgers and Hart wrote what has been called the perfect song, "Isn't It Romantic?" for the film Love Me Tonight. In 2004, the song was deemed to be one of the top 100 ballads in American cinema by the American Film Institute. And here is the king of the romantic balladeers, Tony Bennett, and sorry for those like Michael Bublé.
Music in the night, dreaming.
Christian virtue that is neglected in the church and therefore needs to be developed by us Christian men. The ability to woo a woman is a godly virtue demonstrated in the Bible. The church needs to emphasize romance for the happiness and fulfillment of her marriages and to honor our God who sanctified the institution of marriage at creation. But there is a problem. Godly romance is under assault in our culture. Critics such as the Marxist Richard Middleton write things like this about the view of biblical romance. The romantic lyrical ballad style of the 20th century, Tin Pan Alley, clings stubbornly to its role in the representation of gender relations within the norms set by the stereotype of the bourgeois couple, despite attempts made from time to time to move it into new patterns with new meanings. Well, the new patterns with new meanings that Middleton is referring to are perverse and unbiblical social norms. It is the Christian's responsibility to restore and defend godly romance between a man and a woman. The American Songbook is a powerful weapon at our disposal in what must be our cultural pushback against the scourge of sexual and gender bending and pornography, all of which profane biblical sexual relations. We need to resist the twisting of works of popular art, such as the recent actions by the Men's Gay Chorus of Washington, D.C., which reinterprets the American Songbook to suit their own agenda, unintended, of course, by the original composers and lyricists of the songbook. One example of such distortion is the evocative and sensuous Gershwin song, The Man I Love, written in 1926 for Adele Astaire, but sung here by the great Ella Fitzgerald. After 90 years, the song is still one of Gershwin's most recorded works.